So we drive up to this, I want to call it palatial, but really it's not palatial to me at all. It's modest in its grandeur, if I can just say that, you know. And we're sitting here with owners Troy and Leonard, and I guess I'll start with you, Leonard, because you're closest. I feel a lot of heart in this place, and even though it is a business, it feels like a family to me.
Well, I'm glad you picked up on that. I mean, Troy and I, it's something we've created together from a vision we had to continue to build our business. But, you know, it's really a reflection of our personalities and our style in a lot of ways.
Mm-hmm. And so this is not, you didn't go to school for this. This is sort of like a dream come true for you, isn't it?
It is. It's absolutely a dream come true. And you know, we started the business in 2010, and we had some grand aspirations. And I guess what we're most surprised about is the speed at which we've gotten here and built something as extraordinary as this is.
Mm-hmm. So I'll pass the mic over to Neil, and maybe you can pick up the conversation with Troy.
Yeah, because one of the things that fascinates me about this place, and we've met so many people who are born and raised here, but others who are Texan by choice. So I want to figure out what it is that led you guys to be here in Fort Worth.
So I am born and raised Texas, in Texas, lived all across the state, all the major cities. Landed in Fort Worth in my past career, which was in the oil and gas business. Growing up in West Texas, it's hard to escape it. And, you know, love the city. And at the time, I was kind of at a crossroads where I was contemplating continuing to stay in the oil and gas business. But I also had this kind of burning desire to investigate a whiskey company. And through a series of discussions with my wife, and those were difficult discussions, by the way. You want to do what? You know, came to the conclusion that, you know, at that particular point in my life, you know, why not? Why not give it everything I had? And, you know, it was, as Leonard said, it was a dream and an idea and something that, we had a lot of work ahead of us, but, you know, I think the passion and the tenacity that it took to really power through a lot of the hurdles and the headwinds was really kind of what made us successful in getting to this stage.
So, Leonard, your road to Texas is a little bit different from Troy's.
Yeah, it is indeed. I came here most immediately from New York City, so it was quite a change. Mm-hmm. But I grew up on the East Coast, Maryland area, Washington, D.C. area, and fell in love with Fort Worth and the people here, the culture, the style. It's very unpretentious kind of city, which I really enjoy and love. Great for families. So. Loved all that about it when I moved here, basically sight unseen, and had a successful business, which we sold in the communications industry, and like Troy, just had an idea that of something, an instinct, I guess, in a way as well, to research whiskey distilleries, craft distilleries that I discovered really, the first in Texas was Tito. Tito's Vodka, which he's really the pioneer for us in Texas. But there really weren't a lot of, or any, when we started thinking about it, whiskey distilleries in Texas. And that just sparked an instinct and an idea. And, you know, that was, 2010, we really started working on this. And, you know, to add to what Troy mentioned, I think, and what I said earlier, I think it's important to note that what also helped get us to this point is a great team, number one, and great whiskeys that mm-hmm. we're producing that we've developed a customer fan base that has been extraordinary. We never predicted, our distributor never predicted. And that's, you know, that support that began in Fort Worth and then grew throughout Texas and is now growing across the country helped make this happen.
Mm-hmm. So, but I mean, to create a facility this size is a massive investment, and it's in part a leap of faith, because even though you've had success, it's success on a completely different level, and there is risk involved. So what leads you to go for it? I mean, and what, I guess it's an entrepreneurial spirit, but can you speak to that, Troy?
Sure, absolutely. I think that you hit the nail on the head. It's, and what I would say is, it's almost a reset from where we were. Yeah. So we are taking on the same risk that we did 7 years ago, just in a bigger way, you know, really betting on the long term. And we had a great business in our, you know, original facility, you know, could have continued to build it and grow it. But, you know, as Leonard mentioned a minute ago, we have had since the beginning huge aspirations. You know, we saw an opportunity not only to be a player in the whiskey industry, but to be able to potentially compete, you know, with the folks that have been around a really long time doing it. You know, there were a lot of indicators that suggested it was a good time. You know, I think that our timing was really good. I mean, that's another contributor to, you know, getting to this stage this quickly, is, you know, the industry is seeing a renaissance. You know, people are really interested in the process of making whiskey, interested in trying different whiskeys. The whole classic cocktail culture is kind of booming and coming around again. So for all those reasons, you know, we still feel very good about, you know, our future. And, you know, but we did make an enormous gamble and bet that we're going to be here, you know, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years down the road.
12 hours a day.
Yes.
15 hours a day.
Still making and selling whiskey.
Yeah. So. Okay. Now, because you both have alluded to something, and I you know, we'll talk about the product in a second, because the product looks spectacular. But Rob in the science lab told us, he said it perfectly, and I want to explore this. He says, you know, we had this distillery, and it was a very successful distillery, and we decided that, you know, the distillery had kind of gotten bigger than what we had the capacity for, so naturally we bought a golf course.
So who
wants to explain the idea of what's the land that we're sitting on, and where did this idea come from?
Sure. So I'll take a stab at that, I guess. You know, to produce and mature bourbon and whiskeys, you need property to do it. You need the ability to scale if you're going to be making a lot of product, which we are, a lot of whiskey, which we're doing here. And so you need land and acreage. And it wasn't that we set out to find a golf course to buy. Very fortunately, it turned out that way, because Troy and I both love to golf. And our wives have said to us, do you need another distraction at work, kind of thing.
You know, when are you home?
Yeah,
when
it's like, what is going on? What do you do all day? So, you know, it ended up that way. And, you know, so it worked for us from a business perspective for what we needed operationally. And really the bonus came from this particular course in this piece of property, which has an incredible Fort Worth history. And it was called Glen Garden Country Club. It's the second private golf course built in Fort Worth in 1912. And what it was most notably known for was that it was the home and the place where Byron Nelson and Ben Hogan both grew up simultaneously caddying and learning how to play the game, which is extraordinary. I mean, I'm sure a lot of your listeners are golfers and golf fans, and these are iconic golf figures that have sustained time in their name recognition. And so they both came from here on this dirt that we're on, which is really, as I said, pretty remarkable. So that was the bonus, because it's an asset of Fort Worth. It's certainly an asset of Texas, and, you know, to arguably to the golf industry and the history of golf, to remember those guys and what they did for the game. So, you know, we love the fact that that story is one that we can perpetuate. Becomes part of our story of where we are, why are we here. It's because it has a purpose for what we need to do for a business. What was it? this incredible story of golf.
Sure.
So we love that. And, you know, I think there's now, in the short time that we've been open, more people know that story and that history than probably learned about it in the last, you know, 30, 40 years, who knows. So it's just been great.
Mm-hmm. And it's not like you just picked a plot of land to open up a big facility and grow. It's like this homage to, you know, the rich history of the area, knowing now that there's never going to be a condo unit developed, or, you know, that it won't be, you know, parsed out, and that it'll always be the way it is very exciting. So I have some plans that I think you guys should maybe, you know, put into play in the next couple of years, if you don't mind.
Here we go.
Yeah, well, so I'm walking around and I'm thinking to myself, you know, this place needs a couple of things. First of all, you two need to write a book, because your story is an amazing story. It's a great entrepreneurial story, but it's also a great family story. And then you also need to open a restaurant here, so that the next time we come back and we encourage people to come here, that they can get a bite to eat as well as enjoy some good drinks. So I need the commitment right now on tape that you will both be working on that.
We will work on it. You know, it's a great idea, and ideas that we've thought about as well. You know, a big part of what we do is about providing an experience for people. It's not just about selling whiskey or introducing people to whiskey. It's, as Leonard said earlier, you know, what you see here and kind of the design and, you know, the elements of our brand are all really a reflection of us and kind of what we value, what we enjoy, what we do in our spare time, all of those things. And so, you know, we created this environment not only to produce, but also for people to come and learn about what we do and do it in an environment that you can't get anywhere else. You know, if you're overlooking golf course, you're enjoying a whiskey, you've got this wonderful architecture and these spaces that we've designed that people can come and, you know, hang out in and, you know, experience, you know, fellowship. And it's just a really fun thing to share.
I would be derelict in my duties here if I didn't ask you before we wrap up about the corks. Talk to me about that idea and where that came from.
Oh, you want to? Okay. So the corks were, the genesis of the idea was that we wanted to create parts of our packaging that represented where we were from. So we're in North Texas, we're in Fort Worth in particular, we're in the, you know, oftentimes referred to as the gateway to the West. So a rich, rich cowboy culture here. However, we're not cowboys. We don't ride horses every day. But
you do ride horses, because you did say every day. So
right? Every once in a while.
Gotcha. Okay.
But, you know, we do wear boots. You know, we definitely embrace our heritage here. And so we wanted to figure out a way to incorporate those elements into our package without being, as we call it, cliche or
right.
predictable.
Yep.
And so boots being a big part of our culture, we, you know, kept thinking, how can we possibly figure out a way to put leather or, you know, something that represented boots on our package? And so we were throwing around the idea of, you know, I wonder if we can do anything with the top. And so I'm a hobbyist woodworker, and I've got a wood shop, and I started playing around one afternoon and have a wood lathe. And so I was creating, you know, different prototypes, and I took a pair of my boots that I didn't wear as frequently and, you know, fashioned up, you know, pretty close of what you see today as the top being. Took some pictures of it, sent it to Leonard, said, you know, what do you think? And he was like, man, that's pretty cool. So we, I made several prototypes, brought them in the office, you know, the next week. And we said, you know what, this is what we have to do. So we are not short of ideas. We come up with lots of interesting and often fun ideas, but none of them are easy. I mean, if we would have known how difficult it would have been to create these tops and sustain it and grow it and so forth, you know, chances are we probably wouldn't have stuck with it. But, long story short, we did figure it out, and we continue to perpetuate it. And we use reclaimed boot leathers that we get from local boot makers. So we develop relationships with these folks. Anything that they use to make a boot, we make a top out of. It's grown to the point that really anything that's pliable enough to use for the top of the bottle top, we'll do it. So we've done a ton with charities, corporate events, the military. We started doing welcome home parties where we were using either their fatigues or they would bring their fatigues, they would bring their boots. We would do really unique things, and a lot of times we'd invite them to come and make them with us, which was extremely cool. First responders, and it just started to grow and grow, and it's become kind of a calling card that we never would have expected it to become. It's a collector's item. People are collecting them. They can't find a way to throw them away, so they're contacting us saying, hey, do you have a way to display them? So that's kind of developed into different display pieces and artwork and so on and so forth. So it's a really neat thing.
Wow.